The supercomputer Watson. Not heard of it. Okay. So, last year, right, Watson won Jeopardy, right? Now, Watson is not a person. Is the supercomputer created by IBM. Some of you may be aware of it. So, on Valentine's Day last year, actually, Watson was pitted against human champions, and Watson won. Right. And what is the relevance of Jeopardy, the game of Jeopardy in the US, right? So it's for those of you, again, who are not aware, it's like a game like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. Only thing is that it's a little twisted in the sense that the guy doesn't ask you a question, he gives you clues, you have to come up with the question, right? So that the question is the answer, actually, right? So how it has been done, the way they created this supercomputer was by feeding this computer with millions of pages of information. This is not tables, it's not structured data in the form of rows and columns, but unstructured data, text. So lots of volumes of books were actually digitized and fed to this computer, just like a human brain, you know, over a period of several years, we read and then we become intelligent in the same way. This was fed, and you know, so that's the relevance of big data, and the technology behind it is again Hadoop and so on and so forth, which we'll be touching upon today. All right, and just that, since the audience has increased, let me do a quick introduction about myself. I'm Mohan Kumar, I'm the CEO of Trendwise Analytics. Prior to starting this company, I have about 20 years of experience working for companies like IBM and SAP. I know you all are Uber geeks here, so I graduated from IIT Kharagpur. Somewhere down the line, my geekiness got blunt. Okay, that's what 20 years of corporate life does, perhaps. So we are into big data, and today the topic is basically, what is big data and why should you care? All right, so back to our question of, why this big data has become such a big thing suddenly, right? It's not really new. Only thing is that it was existing earlier. Only companies like Google and Yahoo were using this. But today, with the advent of social media tools, everybody is on the internet generating information. Terabytes and gigabytes and zettabytes of information is being generated, right? So that has led to this big data. It's like a big monster, which consists of not just the structured information, which is in the form of tables, which has always been there, but a lot of unstructured information in the form of text, audio and video files, right? And the businesses across all industries, this is relevant for every industry, public sector, government, everybody, it is relevant, right? They are struggling to get hold of this information and make sense out of it and gain some insights out of it, right? Because data as such is of no use unless you really make sense and get some, what do you call as actionable insights, is a very common term in business analytics, right? So we need to get actionable insights out of this huge volume of information. So that is the reason now it's a big wave. It's like what 15, 20 years back, what ERP was, now big data is becoming such a thing now, right? So that is big data. Now, what is the definition of big data? Obviously, there is no textbook definition as such. There is a, if you will, there is a small thumb rule, right? So what is big data? As the name suggests, anything which is of a data of large volume, typically in the range of a few terabytes, at least a terabyte of data. Plus, it has to have a combination of structured and unstructured information. Right? Again, this is not cast in stone, but just a thumb rule. Because there are situations like in telcos where probably they don't need unstructured data, but their structured data itself is in the range of terabytes. Right? So that's also called big data. But by and large, the definition is it's a combination of structured and unstructured data of large volumes. Now, there are typically three characteristics attributed to big data. This is volume, variety, and velocity. Right? Volume is self-explanatory, so it is large volumes of data. What is variety? Again, this is variety is basically heterogeneity of the data. So it is not just structured information like traditionally how information was stored, but a lot of unstructured, and within that it is not just restricted to text files, right? This, we can use this for handling video, we can do video analysis, for example, this video surveillance data, even audio files and so on and so forth. So all this put together, we call this as big data, right? So again, that's a loose definition. So what is the solution for this big data? Again, there are a couple of, I'll call this big data technology, but there is no such word. Just to help everyone understand, I'm calling this, but there is nothing like big data technology, but there are some platforms and tools that have come up or getting popular, right? Again, Hadoop is not exactly new. This came from Google, by the way, so you all, probably Yahoo. Many of you are, Yahoo and Google as well. Yeah, Google also is. Duck cutting is
Hadoop from, came from Yahoo.
Yahoo, okay. So thanks for that. So duck cutting is from Yahoo or Google? I was under the impression.
Now it's Cloud Era, but
yeah, but earlier it's from
Yahoo.
Yahoo, okay, fine. So it was his son's toy elephant. Hadoop is the name of his son's toy elephant, right? So that's how it started. And then, of course, this was spun off as an open source. Hadoop is right now an open source community. But on top of that, like he mentioned Cloud Era and a few more, I'll just talk about, there are commercial versions of Hadoop as well. So Hadoop has become very popular as a solution for this big data. But there are a few others, like HPCC is one more which is coming up, which is on the same lines, but it is not exactly Hadoop. So this is a platform, and it has a set of tools that help us in processing this large volumes and a variety of data. Now, what are some of the advantages? One of the most advantage, or the biggest advantage, is that it is open source, right? So anybody can access it. So that is number one. Number two, it really helps in processing the data on commodity hardware. So you don't really, earlier it was like you had to have a supercomputer to process this large volume of data, right? But with Hadoop, the main advantage is that you can actually break this into smaller chunks, process it there itself, and then bring it back all together, right? So using commodity hardware, I think that is another big advantage, and it takes care. There are nice tools, and there is a mechanism available to take care of the failover and so on and so forth, right? Fault tolerance and so on and so forth. So that's one of the beauties of this framework or platform, if you will. Very briefly, again, some of you probably are aware, but I'm just touching upon what are the components of Hadoop, and anybody wants to pitch in, please do so. As I said, I'm not a geek, so this is a technical stuff. It consists primarily of three components. One is the storage, right? One of the big problems with big data is the storage, right? So HDFS, or distributed file system, is one of the components, which means that you can build clusters so that the data can be processed within a cluster, on a bunch of computers, and again, these can be commodity hardware. So HDFS is one component. Second is the programming language, or the programming environment, if you will, which is MapReduce, right? So this again helps in processing this whole data, right, in a distributed manner. So that is MapReduce. And the third is basically a bunch of tools to manage this whole thing, right? So that is the common components, as it is called, right? It is, there are several things like Zookeeper, this, that, so that you can manage the whole environment, all right? So these are three main components, and one of the drawbacks, as with any open source open source community or open source software, is managing it in terms of the various releases and versions and so on and so forth, right? So some companies have kind of taken advantage of that, right? And they said, okay, fine, we have a core component of open source, and they have gone ahead and commercialized, and we have commercialized versions of Hadoop available. again, this list is by no means exhaustive, just an indicative list. So Cloud Era was one of the, early guys to come into this play. Obviously, I think Doug Cutting is the guy who founded this, and obviously he is there. And then there are others like Hortonworks. I just wanted to point out HPCC, and there are, I guess, a couple of other vendors like HPCC. They are not really based on Hadoop, right? The philosophy is the same, okay? But just to give a little bit of background, because they are also our partners, the way HPCC has come up is they are, again, a spin-off of a company called LexisNexis. And they were into content management, right? And they had a similar situation like a Yahoo or a Google, where they had to manage unstructured information. So they developed their own, again, proprietary technology, and they were actually selling it earlier, and now they also made it open source, right? So that's the power of open source, I guess. So we're getting a lot of stuff for free. And of course, IBM, IBM has come up with their version of Hadoop called Big Insights. The advantage here is, now since I come from IBM, the advantage here is that they have added a little more flavor to that in terms of processing, streaming data, and so on, right? So their version is called Big Insights, and they have a component which can process streaming data and so on and so forth. And then, of course, EMC GreenPlum. This is, again, EMC GreenPlum was the company which they acquired, EMC Square. Any questions so far? Again, as I said, this is, you know, soon after lunch, very difficult, so just to keep you guys awake, yeah.
So is there a certain class of problems that are solved by this Hadoop environment, or, you know, you can solve anything that we that we do can be done by Hadoop?
Right, very good question. I'll come to that. I have a slide on the use cases. Today, of course, pretty much what we say is that we can solve any kind of a problem. But again, this is like a pie in the sky. But there are specific use cases which I will touch upon, industry specific, maybe we can touch upon.
See, it's a distributed environment, so the only kinds of problems that you can solve are problems where breaking the problem down and then bringing the result back together is allowed. So, the operation must be commutative so that you can bring the result back together, otherwise you can't distribute it. So,
I think
you can run it on one machine, but that's not really the point. The point is that you need a problem that can be, the results of which can be added back together, like taking average of 100,000 items, right? So you can take 10,000, 10,000, 10,000, take averages, and then average out the entire thing. Because the operation is commutative, you can distribute it, but otherwise you can't. So there is a limit on the operation you can do.
Thanks. That's one. Another also is that you probably will not be able to do a lot of real-time analytics using this. So the idea here is you take a large amount of historical data, analyze it, and then, you know, show the results, kind of thing.
Any specific reason as to why it has been limited to only historical data and not real-time data?
Maybe someone wants to, because I'm not a technical guy.
It's a technical challenge, speed of distribution. See, what you're trying to do is take real low-end hardware and make it do something as quickly as possible. And because with that scale, it wasn't really designed for speed, but it was more designed for scale. So that's kind of the original design goal. But a lot of people, like IBM Insights, actually tries to do real-time thing. But the real-time results, there's also a company called Hadept, which is which is by this really big-time database guru who's written the core of several big DBs. And they are also trying to solve the real-time problem in Hadoop. But that's really a physical problem of sending data out to several. So the data streaming to several machines takes longer than the data analysis on those machines. But still, you know, it's a challenge, I think. Yeah.
So I guess here what we meant by historical is not like really old data, but it's a store and process. So you could have stored it from yesterday or maybe an hour back.
Yeah. So, any other?
This space is moving, I mean, this is a jungle out there in terms of the tools. I mean, based on the
very true. Well put, yeah.
You can go back and, like, you know, pick from the salad bar. So.
Okay, any other questions?
So if you're talking about government, working, would this, something like this, be appropriate?
Yes.
You're talking, you don't need very high
Absolutely, absolutely. So, for example, I mean, of course, hardware. So, you don't really need to. So, earlier the issue was since you had to put everything in kind of one block, right? So, you needed to have a very powerful machine and then huge storage as well connected to that. Now, here you can actually split this whole thing into smaller pieces. So, and this hardware can be commodity hardware, right? In government also it is applicable. In fact, these guys at UID are already using Hadoop, right? So it's already being used because they're more than that. I think it is the volume of data.
In fact, that was the question I was asking them.
Right.
But I didn't get an answer. Do you have an answer as to what hardware they're using?
Not exactly the hardware part of it, but from a platform, even I don't know that,
okay,
I'm sorry.
Okay.
But I just asked them about the platform and they confirmed that they're using Hadoop. Right? So
okay.
so that's definitely there, but they can enhance that because a lot of power of Hadoop is also in processing unstructured data. So if you just have structured data, probably you're not getting 100% of Hadoop. Right, so it really helps when you start getting, and that will probably happen soon, right? So for example, once they start using UID, there will be a lot of feedback, people telling them through communities and so on and so forth. And I think that they can actually leverage, so put that back. Because one of the use cases I'm going to touch upon is the social media analytics. It's a big use case of using big data and Hadoop.
Can I just jump in on the
question? Yeah, sure, please.
I think that Sanjay Jain probably assumed that you understood his answer. It is HDFS. There is nothing magic there.
No, but HDFS again.
In UID.
You're saying
context.
That he assumed that I knew that it was
when you, when he said Hadoop.
A very difficult assumption, but yes. Okay.
I mean, he didn't have anything to hide. I mean, it was
I'm sure he didn't have anything to hide, but I didn't get the answer. So I was like,
Doesn't still answer a question of what kind of hardware. I mean, see, you can have
commodity
HDFS.
x86. I can tell you that.
Okay.
Sorry, because commodity x86.
Okay. Because I mean, that need not be necessarily true. I'm just saying. Because, you know, you use HDFS and you have a powerful computer because government can afford it, right? So these are the use cases that I was referring to, and let me know if you know, I'll touch upon some of them in a little more detail, but if you need some more, I can talk about. So I think social media analytics is the most commonly used use case within big data, right? Because that is the easiest in terms of getting the data. It's public data, which is available on the web. You find a problem saying, okay, what are people talking about a particular brand? If somebody wants to, let's say, Walmart wants to do a study about, you know, what's the buzz around their brand, what are people talking about, so they can actually use big data to, you know, or the big data technology, as I was saying, or how to use, gather all this information, right, and put that and do a sentiment analysis and what have you, right? There are others, like, for example, in fact, there are a lot of tools also readily available on. One is social mention, for example, which they already, you know, directly do that. So, but social media analytics in general is one of the use cases. There are other industry specific.
Social
retail
mention is an open source tool.
Which one?
Is it an open source tool?
Social mention, no. It is not really open source, but it is a kind of a free tool.
Okay.
So they are an application. There's a website available there. You tell what kind of information or what keywords you want to do an analysis,
okay,
and they will give you the result, right? And there are a bunch of such applications available online. And then there are specific to industry. Retail is a big area. I don't know if some of you have read this article about a girl's father knowing about, you know, the girl being pregnant, right? So that's an extreme case. But that's how retail is using information and you know, trying to do micro segmentation of the customers, sending them campaigns, right, and so promotions and so on and so forth. So again, a lot of it is done with social media data rather, But a lot of it is also done using their point of sale data, and all that gets accumulated. So that is in retail. Similarly, in telco, in case some of you are not aware, there is something called CDR data, which runs into millions of records, which is basically call data records, I guess. That's a full form. So CDR, and then OSS data, which is again not directly related to the customer, but again there where the calls have been, how the calls have been directed, and so on and so forth. Again, the volume here comes into play. It's not really the unstructured data as such, but the volumes are really huge and we need to process it faster. That's another advantage, right? So since you're splitting this and processing over several computers, it's much faster than if you had not done that, right? So, and in telco, for example, they have millions of records and they need to process almost on a daily basis, either to run some campaigns or gather some insights or whatever, right? So telco is another. Similarly, healthcare, okay? Healthcare has two dimensions to it. Healthcare, one is obviously healthcare information about the people, and then this is related to the government, right? So which areas are prone to some certain kind of diseases and so on and so forth. There's also another part of this which probably I did not touch. There's a lot of sensor data that is generated, right, from all kinds of sensors, and this again is probably not restricted to healthcare, but that is again very relevant in case of big data. So there are RFIDs generated data and all this stuff, and healthcare is a prime example of that. Utilities, obviously, I think in the morning we were talking about utilities data presentation Anand was doing. So again, a great example where large volumes of data, especially with smart metering and so on, right? So there's a lot of data that gets generated from all these meters and so on. So that's another use case. India's UID project I already mentioned, Aadhaar. GIS, we talked a lot about, right, in the throughout the course of the day. We are also doing a POC with one of our clients using GIS information. Prime case, SCADA data is all available. And very often, see, today what happens is, in fact, a lot of people are not even aware that they can use this data, because traditionally it has been there like, okay, I can't store more than 1 terabyte of data, delete it or back it up and keep it, that's it, right? So now that slowly we need to also increase the awareness to the people that, okay, you can actually use that data, make sense out of it, and really, you know, probably even monetize it. We have to increase that awareness as well. Another example or a use case is surveillance data, right? And when I say surveillance, this is primarily, we have so many malls and, you know, even in countries like UK and all, there are cameras around the streets, right? So very often what happens is, again, because of lack of storage and all that stuff, they either just store 2 days of data and then back it up everything, and then to get that back is a huge problem. And typically they don't do any analysis. So if they have to find out something, some incident happened yesterday, probably they'll be able to do. But if something has happened a week back, it's a huge, major process to get all that back and then run through the whole thing, right? So this is another area. There are a few companies already, I cannot recall top of my mind, but there are companies already doing video analysis and so on and so forth. Okay, so I will quickly touch upon the market size and then open up for questions. So, and also basically why should you care, right, the question. So quickly on the market size, there are, again, since this is an upcoming area, very difficult to get this data, but there was one very aggressive market analysis done, and they put it at about $50 billion by 2015.
Gartner says the BI market itself is going to be around 15,
again,
16 billion.
Again,
so this is just...
I know, again, this I'm the messenger here. These are not my numbers. Okay.
What is the source of that first data point?
Okay, I'll tell you that. It was on the web, and but I couldn't get that right away. But IDC is definitely one source, which is 18 billion, and that's why I mentioned that's a very aggressive one, the first one. But it feels nice to say that we are in that market, right? 50 billion. Okay. So, but I think this is, yeah, you're right. This is more realistic. 17, 18 billion is more realistic. But the point is, the growth is really very high. 40%, I think, is a huge growth. And why should you care? I think primarily because for all of us, there's a lot of opportunity. People who are looking for change, or people who want to start a business, or people who have some good ideas, right? Innovation, in all respects, and that's one of the primary reasons why we should care about it. Okay. So with that, I would like to stop and take any questions. I have a few slides on what we did, but I think it is not required now. Yeah.
Would you say that there's a relationship between big data and social network analysis? I mean,
yes.
Like, could you maybe talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. So social network analysis is in a way related to big data, in the sense that, you know, what you try to do in social network analysis is how influential is a person, right? And to find that out, it may appear to be a very simple problem, but actually it is not. You need to really do a recursive analysis of the data to find out. For example, one simple use case we were trying to do was using the CDR data. Can we find out within the network, who is the guy who is probably most influential among the 100 people whom he knows? And can we get that guy to, you know, promote about this network and so on, right? Now, that needs a lot of processing, and that needs obviously processing a large volume of data. So there is definitely a connection. Any other? Yeah. I think
can I add something?
I think he yeah.
So Hadoop,
yeah, we'll just come
major,
back.
No. Yeah. Hadoop's major market is about analysis and graphical processing.
Do we use it on a second day analysis kind of stuff.
Do we have any other product which is coming up? Do we have a market for this where big data actually plays a role?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
So
there is absolutely a market, and that's why, as I mentioned, the big insights of IBM has a small component which can tackle that kind of somewhat streaming data or a little bit real-time data, right? So there is a big market for that, or a demand for that, but right now we don't have any mature product, if you will, right? Yeah, you wanted to add something, and then I will come to your question.
Sir. To your point on social analytics, right? Hadoop's a very simple, from an idea perspective, it's a very simple idea that you send out data to several different machines and get the work done there and get it back, right? Get the results back, put them together, and start working with the result. So Hadoop can handle problems like social data analysis, but it would still not be a very simple problem, because the algorithm to understand the text itself is a complex task. So there are people working on text analysis in separate form. So Hadoop's not the solution there. And to your point, there are several players in the market. Actually, you mentioned EMC Greenplum.
Yeah.
There's Aster Data. There's SAP HANA.
But the question was real time. None of them do real time.
They very much do real time because they're in memory solutions, unlike Hadoop.
In memory is different from real time. Okay.
So
we can have that debate.
The point of in memory is.
And your title, like a big picture, something attracted
me.
So point is, like, you have two different sets of data.
Yes.
Like one lying with one ministry, one set of data with another ministry. Two big department, two different MIS is functioning well.
Yes.
And people like us, like a struggle, like what is the relationship we can have?
Right.
So what kind of technology solution you can offer, like so that we can understand and say that this is the thing, like this is the with different set of data, different MIS,
absolutely.
And how you something concrete, okay, this is the relationship.
Okay, so again, probably we can take it up offline as well, but this is definitely within the scope of big data and Hadoop. This is a very typical scenario, it's not very specific to you. So we can get data from different sources, merge it together, process it, and analyze it as one unit, and then get the insights out of it. That's highly possible, and maybe we can get into specifics. If that is okay, we can take it offline. Yeah. All right. I think we are, any final questions, or I think we are running out of time.
Yeah.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.